Chapter 15. Ismay's part in the drama. Ismay and Lightoller. So was Ismay great-uncle Bertie's nemesis? He was certainly the man to whom my great-uncle was accountable throughout his entire career with the White Star Line. Charles Herbert Lightoller was born in Chorley, Lancashire, a mere 20 miles or so from Crosby, where Joseph Bruce Ismay had entered this life some 12 years previously. There, the tenuous connection ends. Ismay was educated at Harrow, one of England's most prestigious and most expensive schools. Lightoller's schooling was scant, and, running off to sea at 13, his studies were mainly confined to literally learning the ropes aboard some of the world's most demanding sailing ships. Rightly, his education could be said to have been obtained at the University of Life. Ismay came from a shipping family. His mother, Margaret Bruce, was the daughter of a shipowner, Luke Bruce. Her husband, Thomas Ismay, was the senior partner in the shipping company Ismay, Imre & Co. and was also the founder of the White Star Line. J. Bruce Ismay's education was completed in France before he was apprenticed to his father's firm. Following this, he toured the world prior to moving to New York to work for the White Star Line. There, at the age of 26, he married Julia Delaplaine, with whom he had 5 children. Just 3 years after his marriage, Ismay moved his family back to Britain when he became a partner in his father's firm. When Thomas Ismay died in 1899, he left the family business to his son. 3 years later, Ismay agreed to merge the firm with an American shipping conglomerate, the International Mercantile Marine Company. However, by 1904, Ismay had become head of International Mercantile Marine with the backing of the all-powerful billionaire J.P. Morgan. Lightoller's life, prior to setting sail on board the Titanic, could hardly have been more different from that of his ultimate commander, J. Bruce Ismay. In his autobiography, Titanic and Other Ships, Lightoller says, "Few boys that go to sea are born to be drowned." Grandma Gertrude told me on more than one occasion that great Uncle Bertie would boast to her that the sea would never drown him. Giants of the Sea. In the early years of the 20th century, Cunard, White Star Line's chief competition on the transatlantic run, launched her two magnificent liners, the Lusitania and the Mauritania. Ismay was determined to beat Cunard at their own game and decided to build a trio of ships that would be bigger, faster, and more luxurious than those of any of his rivals. He aimed, with his vast leviathans, to dominate once and for all the sea between Britain and America. He firmly believed that this plan would generate considerable revenue for his company in two ways. Firstly, by offering wealthy first-class passengers unparalleled luxury in their surroundings on a transatlantic voyage. They would pay handsomely for the privilege of being transported effortlessly across a vast ocean in such comfort. But also, provision would be made, on the decks, below the millionaires, aristocrats, and affluent middle-class passengers, for an unprecedented number of those travelling third-class or steerage. The cost of a Titanic ticket. It is interesting to note the price discrepancy between the cost of the first-class parlour suite at £870 and a steerage ticket at £3. Which meant that the richest of the rich were paying almost 300 times more for the same journey as many Irish who were leaving their own country to settle in America. At a comparable rate today, that would mean roughly $106,000 for a first-class parlour suite on the Titanic and $362 to travel steerage. The giant trio of oceanic liners that Ismay was obsessed with launching on a vast and capricious ocean were the Olympic, the Titanic, and the Britannic. Titanic was the second of these superliners to be built by the Belfast shipping yard Harland & Wolff. To accommodate the ship's luxurious features, including a vast promenade for the wealthy to stroll along, Ismay decided to reduce the number of lifeboats in davits, as opposed to the 4 collapsibles, to 16 from 48, the minimum required under current Board of Trade regulations. As the dream ship prepared to sink forever beneath the ocean, that Ismay had expected to conquer, he escaped in a lifeboat reserved for women and children, an act he would be haunted by for the rest of his life. Ismay accused. At the Senate inquiry, some passengers testified that during the voyage they had heard Ismay pressurizing Captain Smith to go faster, with the object of arriving in New York ahead of schedule, and so generating some useful press coverage. One passenger also claimed to have seen Ismay flaunting one of the iceberg warning messages at the dinner table before placing it back in his pocket. It was suggested by another that Ismay had asked for a speed test to take place on the 14th of April, not long before the collision. However, this has never been proved, although, as Sir Ernest Shackleton's testimony to the British inquiry made clear, the Titanic appeared to have been travelling far too fast on the fateful night. The crucial telegram. On the afternoon of Sunday the 14th of April, at approximately 5 o'clock, Mrs. Emily Ryerson and Mrs. Marianne Thayer were watching the sun go down from the first-class deck of the Titanic. Sadly, both of them were to lose their husbands when the ship sank some 9 hours later. They were approached by J. Bruce Ismay, dressed as usual in his best, who inquired if their staterooms were comfortable. Emily Ryerson had some slight acquaintance with Ismay through mutual friends on board, and he thrust a Marconigram at her, announcing that they were now among icebergs. When a remark was made about the speed of the ship, he replied that although the ship had not been going fast, they were to start up extra boilers that afternoon. Noticing that the message also mentioned a distressed liner, the Deutschland, which appeared to be in difficulties, Mrs. Ryerson later remarked that Ismay scoffed at the idea of the Titanic coming to its rescue, announcing that they had no time for such matters, as our ship wanted to do the best. Something was also said about getting in on Tuesday night. When questioned later about this conversation, Ismay, who many people consider to have a remarkable memory, could only recall the presence of Mrs. Thayer. Ismay in love. Frances Wilson, in her book How to Survive the Titanic or The Sinking of J. Bruce Ismay, shows Marianne Thayer to be a vivacious woman who was able to spellbind all those who came in contact with her. She was a collector of life stories. People talked to Marianne Thayer as they would to no one else, and Ismay found her particular kind of American openness totally fascinating. There was no doubt that his interest in her was something that would stay with him for much of his life. Whenever he saw her, he looked for a reason to detain her, and on the afternoon of the 14th of April, on the deck of the Titanic, he had the perfect excuse. Although it was to Emily Ryerson that he showed the Marconigram, it was Marianne Thayer that his attention was drawn to, before placing the message from the Baltic back in his pocket. Frances Wilson tells us that while Mrs. Ryerson told the story to the press, Mrs. Thayer said nothing about the encounter herself. When the time came for Mrs. Ryerson to sign her affidavit, it may have been Marianne Thayer who persuaded her to withhold Ismay's comments about lighting further boilers to get through the ice, remarking the poor man was going through enough already. The relationship between Ismay and Marianne Thayer continued by letters long after the sinking, and it is said that he read and reread her letters every night. My second cousin, Lady Louise Patten, in her book Good as Gold, maintains that it was on Ismay's orders that Titanic continued sailing at speed after the impact with the iceberg, when, had the ship remained stationary, she might have taken less water and therefore stayed afloat until help arrived. This and other interesting claims by Lady Patten were verified during conversations with both her mother and her grandmother, Sylvia Lightoller, my great aunt.